Good morning. We are glad that you have tuned in to worship with us at the Episcopal Diocese of Fort Worth. You might take a moment to light a candle or take a few deep breaths to center yourself as we worship our God. Blessed be the one holy and living God. Glory to God forever and ever. Amen. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High. Jesus Christ with the Holy Spirit. In the glory of God the Father. Amen.
God be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Grant to us, Lord, we pray, the Spirit to think and do always those things that are right, that we who cannot exist without you may by you be enabled to live according to your will. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Genesis. Jacob settled in the land where his father had lived as an alien, the land of Canaan. This is the story of the family of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, was shepherding the flock with his brothers. He was a helper to the sons of Bilhah and Zilpah, his father's wives. And Joseph brought back a bad report of them to his father. Now, Israel loved Joseph more than any of the other children because he was the son of his old age, and he had made him a long robe with sleeves. But when the brothers saw that their father loved him more than all of his brothers, they hated him, and they could not speak peaceably to him. Now his brothers went to pasture their father's flock near Shechem. And Israel said to Joseph, "Are not your brothers pasturing the flock at Shechem? Come, I will send you to them." He answered, "Here I am." So he said to him, "Go now, see if it is well with your brothers and with the flock, and bring word back to me." So he sent him from the valley of Hebron. He came to Shechem, and a man found him wandering in the fields. And the man asked him, "What are you seeking?" "I am seeking my brothers," he said. "Tell me, please, where they are pasturing their flock." The man said, "They have gone away. I heard them say, 'Let us go to Dothan.'" So Joseph went after his brothers and found them at Dothan. They saw him from a distance, and before he came near to them, they conspired to kill him. They said to one another, "Here comes this dreamer. Come now, Let's kill him and throw him into one of the pits. Then we shall say that a wild animal has devoured him, and we shall see what will become of his dreams. But when Reuben heard it, he delivered them out of his hands, saying, let us not take his life. Reuben said to them, shed no blood. Throw him into this pit here in the wilderness, but lay no hand on him, that he might rescue him out of their hand and restore him to their father. So when Joseph came to his brothers, they stripped him of his robe, the long robe with sleeves that he wore, and they took him and threw him into the pit. The pit was empty. There was no water in it. Then they sat down to eat, and looking up, they saw a caravan of Ishmaelites coming from Gilead with their camels, carrying gum, balm, resin, on their way to carry it down to Egypt. Then Judah said to his brothers, what profit is it if we kill our brother and conceal his blood? Come, let's sell him to the Ishmaelites and not lay our hands on him, for he is our brother, our own flesh. And his brothers agreed. When some Midianite traders passed by, they drew Joseph up, lifting him out of the pit, and sold him to the Ishmaelites for 20 pieces of silver. And they took Joseph to Egypt. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Let us read Psalm 105 in unison. Give thanks to the Lord and call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the peoples. Sing to him, sing praises to him, and speak of all his marvelous works. Glory in his name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Search for the Lord and his strength. Continually seek his face. Remember the marvels he has done, his wonders and the judgments of his mouth. O offspring of Abraham, his servant, O children of Jacob, his chosen. Then he called for a famine in the land and destroyed the supply of bread. He sent a man before him, Joseph, who was sold as a slave. They bruised his feet in fetters, his neck they put in an iron collar, until his prediction came to pass. The word of the Lord tested him. The king sent and released him. The ruler of the peoples set him free. He set him as a master over his household, as a ruler over all his possessions, to instruct his princes according to his will, and to teach his elders wisdom. Hallelujah.
A reading from the letter to the Romans. Moses writes concerning the righteousness that comes from the law, that the person who does these things will live by them. But the righteousness that comes from faith says, do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven? That is to bring Christ down. Or who will descend into the abyss? That is to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you, on your lips and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For one believes with the heart and so is justified, and one confesses with the mouth and is so saved. The scripture says, no one who believes in him will be put to shame. For there is no distinction between the Jew and the Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all and is generous to all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. But how are they to call on one in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in one whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone to proclaim him? And how are they to proclaim him unless they are sent? And as it is written, how beautiful at the feet of those who bring good news, the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead to the other side while he dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone, but by this time the boat, battered by the waves, was far from the land, for the wind was against them. And early in the morning, he came walking toward them on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "It is a ghost." They cried out in fear, but immediately, Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." Jesus answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." He said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat, started walking on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he noticed the strong wind, he became frightened, and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying to him, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" When they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshiped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
There they are. It's been a long day. There was feeding all those 5,000 people, plus women and children. There was tidying up afterward, picking up all the leftovers. And people back then were probably no tidier at picnic time than we are now. I would imagine that the disciples planned just kind of camp out that night, just to stay where they were, talk about the day, and think about what had happened. But Jesus had other plans. And he said, "Get in the boat and go to the other side." So they did. And now it's deep in the night, dark in the night, at the darkest point that comes just before the dawn. They are tired. The storm has kept them from moving forward as they wanted to, as they thought they could. The wind is so strong that they can't move forward, and they're perhaps unwilling to return, or perhaps even unable. They are stuck out there in the middle of the sea. And it's dark. It's night. And we know what happens in the night. All of our fears come into play. It's hard to recognize anything. We get lost in our own houses in the night because nothing looks like it usually does. And all of a sudden, they see a figure way out on the water, walking toward them. And it's night, and it's dark. And they're terrified, and their vision narrows, and all they can hear is their pulses in their ears. And they're calling out in their fear. And Jesus answers. Immediately, when he hears their voices, Jesus answers. He says, "It is I. Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid." Now, the next logical step at that point would be for them to call for help, to ask Jesus to come help them. But that's not what happens. Peter steps to the edge of the boat, maybe a foot away, and says, "If it's really you, give me a sign. If it's you, let me know. If it's you, command me to walk out there on the water toward you." Now, Jesus has patience with Peter, almost as much patience as he has with me and you. And he says, "Come on down." So Peter somehow gets out of that boat and starts walking across the water. Wow. Walking on the water out to the Lord. It could not get much better than this, could it? He's walking out there, and there's Jesus right there in front of him, and he's walking toward him. And all of a sudden, he notices the wind, and he notices the water, and he realizes what he is doing, and he starts sinking. And in his faith and in his fear, he reaches out and he calls, "Lord, save me." And Jesus is right there. He's right there. And he reaches his hand out to him. And then they're at the boat. So, whatever made Peter think that walking on the water out to Jesus was a good thing? He's just seen Jesus feed 5,000 people with a handful of bread and fish. He has seen healings of Lord knows how many people. He sounds like one of the people who are always asking Jesus to prove that he's the Messiah. Peter, who's been with him all this time. Where did that notion come from? Did he want to imitate Jesus? Is that how he believed he could best follow him to do exactly what he was doing? Or perhaps he needed to affirm that he had special status, that he was one of Jesus' favorite kids, that of all the disciples, Jesus would want him to walk with him on the water. Now, Peter was special, but he was not called to walk on water. He was called to be the rock. Rocks don't walk on water. Rocks give stability to structures. Rocks give strength for buildings. Rocks are a center for growth. Rocks are a place where people can gather. Peter wasn't called to imitate Jesus, but to be a central part of the growth of the small community that was gathering around Jesus. His real walk happened later when he stood firm in faith as leader of the young community in full defiance and opposition of the Roman authorities. So you know what the next question is. What about us? Each one of us is special. Each one of us is unique. Every human on this earth is a unique creation out of God's goodness, God's love, and God's energy. Each of us is special, and at one time or another, each of us has acted out of that specialness in a way that maybe doesn't answer God's call to us. I speak from my own experience. Perhaps you're different. When we're in that space of needing to be special, it's hard to see what's happening around us. It's easy to forget who and whose we are. And sometimes it ends up with us doing things that make other people, and even us in retrospect, wonder what in the world we were thinking. Those of us who have been around for a while know that it's easy to get pulled off course, to lose our way, to fail to see the holy right there in front of us. Especially in these times when the darkness seems to gather around us, when there is no certainty, when we don't know what tomorrow will bring, when we're concerned for the world, for our families, for our country, for ourselves. It's easy to lose our way, and it's easy to lose sight of the holy that's right there in front of us. And so we gather. We gather in whatever way we can, whether it's like this, whether it's across 6 feet in the grocery store, whether it's outside where we can move a little more freely. We gather in whatever way we can to listen for the voice and to reach for the hand, to remember that we are part of community, that we are rocks, each of us, in our own special way. We gather to remember that God holds us, loves us, and empowers us to be Christ's hands, feet, and voice in this world that needs the holy, the presence of the holy, so much. This is our call. This is our call and the very good news is that we don't have to do it alone. We have each other, and Jesus has promised that he is with us even to the end of the age. And to that, I say thanks be to God.
Please stand with me now as we join with voices of Christians around the world, proclaiming our faith as we say, we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. In peace, we pray to you, Lord God.
For all people in their daily life and work.
For our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone.
For this community, the nation, and the world.
For all who work for justice, freedom, and peace.
For the just and proper use of your creation.
For the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression.
For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble.
For those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy.
For the peace and unity of the Church of God.
For all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek the truth.
For Michael, our presiding bishop, and Scott, our bishop, and all bishops and other ministers.
For all who serve God in the church.
For the special needs and concerns of this congregation. Hear us, Lord, for your mercy
is great.
We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life. We will exalt you, O God, our King.
And praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them.
Who put their trust in you. Let us pray also for the forgiveness of our sins. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart, and we have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may walk in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through the grace of Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, together we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
And the blessing of God Almighty, Creator, Redeemer, and Sanctifier, rest upon you this moment and remain with you always. Amen. Amen. Let us go forth into the world to love and serve God and each other. Thanks be to God.